Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us. This is the Great Northern LCC webinar series. Today's speakers are Sean Finn, Tim Kearns, and Leanne Wilson. They're going to be talking to you about their landscape conservation management and analysis portal. You have the ability to ask questions. Please hold them to the end and then submit them online on the GoToWebinar in the questions box. After all the questions have been submitted at the end of the seminar, I will go ahead and read them to our presenters, and then they will answer them. So without further ado, we will go ahead and begin.
Thank you, Leslie. This is Sean Finn, Science Coordinator for the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative, and thank you, everyone, for joining us today. I might add just one quick bit of housekeeping. If you're having trouble viewing or hearing this webinar, please use that chat feature to let Leslie know that there's a problem, because otherwise at this point we wouldn't know. Of course, if you're not hearing me, then we won't know at all. But again, thanks for joining us today, and we're going to talk to you today about a geospatial and data management tool that we've been developing with our partners here at the Fort Collins Science Center in Fort Collins, Colorado, called LCMAP, or the Landscape Conservation Management and Analysis Portal. The general idea is to allow online real-time collaboration on geospatial analyses and data management and product delivery. We felt that there was a need for this in the GNLCC, and it's been collaborated and backed up by a number of our LCC partners across the nation, is as this slide that we're looking at right now demonstrates. And I thank Yvette Converse, the coordinator for the Great Northern LCC, for this slide. Depressing as it is, it indicates that the problems that we're dealing with are ramping up quickly, partly due to increasing populations and the way that we use resources across our nation, and the problems that those are causing are becoming more and more landscape issues, and the sort of the old model of working within jurisdictional boundaries is being dissolved for us, whether we like it or not. Fortunately, since it's the 21st century, we have a number of technological tools at our hands, and things like just the ability to communicate, our computation abilities, and our ability to transfer and deliver data is improving every day. But along with those opportunities comes a lot of expectations here, and it's where that opportunity meets expectation is where LCMAP falls in. You know, the way that we used to do things is sort of working at our desks, and this is, you know, it seems like ancient history here, but we're only talking about the 1990s, where you had researchers and managers kind of working on their own particular things. You have people like GIS specialists and modelers that are working on their individual issues, and they deliver something, you know, they work on some data and they deliver a publication or a management plan. And because the communication pieces weren't necessarily in place the way we wanted them, there was a lot of stovepiping going on, and we recognized that this kind of model here isn't going to help us solve these large landscape and multi-disturbance issues. You know, all about, you know, the 1990s and then into the 2000s, a lot of agencies and organizations went to a more of an enterprise system where the data was probably stored on a network, and you had not only individuals working at their desktops, but teams of people that were able to access common data through their network and use that data and basically share it in real time. So that network capability kind of gave us the opportunity to be more effective in these collaborative teams. But what happens when your particular agency was pulling in outside stakeholders or partners? Could they access that data? In some cases, yes, but in a lot of cases, no. There are various reasons why we have important firewalls that protect this information, and it's not only something that was hindering our ability to work collaboratively, but it also is something that we need to address going forward here, because there are safety and security issues we need to honor and respect, but at the same time, we need to break down that firewall and make our collaborations more effective. So this model that we talked about, where you have those types of projects producing individual products, is actually really was never true. It's just that we didn't have the tools and the technologies that helped us do that. So, for example, when a resource manager is working on a management plan, well, they want to get information from that publication, and of course there are ways to do that, but maybe they even want to get information from that went into creating the publication, like the raw data, and maybe looking at a table in the paper publication wasn't enough. They need to be able to access that data. And of course, the researcher needs support from various kinds of specialists to generate the information that they need to make synthetic publication possible so that we can eventually get to this management plan. And you realize, you know, when you start thinking about the interdependencies that we all have, it gets kind of complex. But going back to that first slide and how are we going to effectively manage these resources and develop comprehensive conservation plans that are effective and are actually defending our natural resources while at the same time letting, you know, a useful bit of that those resources get into human population hands. We do that by everyone working together to develop comprehensive and collaborative conservation and management plans, and that's sort of the model that we're heading to. You know, the data is pretty clear. Across the federal government and state governments and various private enterprises, we're spending a ton of money, billions of dollars every year on natural resource conservation delivery. Are we doing it effectively? Well, I think we all recognize in various ways we're not being as effective as we can. We need the tools that allow us to be more effective and to spend this conservation dollar more efficiently. You know, the outlook for the economy, and of course I'm no economist, but it just doesn't look good to me, and I don't think these numbers are going to be there in the future, so we need to be more efficient with the way that we spend our dwindling conservation dollars. So this old model of people working sort of in their own sort of little worlds out there trying to solve issues that are, you know, without being collaborative is the old way. The new way is to have this overlap of coordinated communication and collaboration, and this overlap not only indicates that sort of the traditional groups that are identified as conservation partners, that is the federal agencies and the state agencies and the tribes and NGOs, are now being joined by a whole slew of other interest groups and stakeholders, and that's why there's more than three circles here on this map. We all need to work geographically, jurisdictionally, operationally, and institutionally in a very collaborative sense. And today we're going to focus specifically on this operational piece of it when we talk about the Landscape Conservation Management and Analysis Portal, or LCMAP. It is a product of the Great Northern Conservation Cooperative, but it is not only a GNLCC product. Many other groups, LCCs and other groups across the nation are working towards these similar solutions. Part of the challenge is to sort of see where the commonalities in these problems and solution sets are and to identify how they operate together. And part of the challenge is to convince our conservation partners that these tools will be useful, and that's what we hope to show you today. I'll give you a quick brief background on the LCCs in case you're not familiar with them. Landscape Conservation Cooperatives are a U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and Department of the Interior initiative. It is strongly supported by Secretary Ken Salazar. Operationally, the nation was identified into eco-regions, essentially, landscape regions that were based on bird conservation regions, and there are 22 across the nation, and each one of these LCCs are charged with coordinating conservation within the region such that multiple partner collaborations are effective and those conservation dollars that we mentioned are spent effectively. In the Northern Rocky region and the Columbia Plateau, the LCC is exemplified by the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative, and we identified a primary purpose to create, facilitate, and achieve a collective landscape vision among conservation partners. I might add here that each one of these LCCs are actually directed by a steering committee that have representatives from state, federal, tribal, NGO, and other stakeholders that are involved in the decision process. So, decisions are not made through some Department of the Interior hierarchy, but they are rather at the LCC level, at each LCC level, they are made by a committee of leadership from across the region. Today, when we describe LCMAP to you, we're going to talk about a justification, which I've already covered at least a little bit, then we'll talk a little bit idea, we'll cover those topics. And then we'll go into a demonstration of how various elements in the LC map work. And we'll finish up talking about efficiencies and some of the bigger picture issues. So, again, we're working on this new collaborative paradigm, and operationally we can be most effective in conserving natural resources over very large landscapes by being efficient in the way we access common framework data, that is the baseline data, elevation data, climate data, roads, etc., that we all use to understand how changes to the landscape are occurring. We also need to ensure that there's fast, efficient data documentation, that is documenting the metadata, or documenting with metadata, the data that we deliver, the models that we derive or create. We need to vet, share, and use effective analyses and modeling tools in common work environments. And we need to communicate this result, not only to our colleagues and to our partners that are out managing resources in the field, but to the general public to ensure that they recognize that we're spending these conservation dollars wisely. So from practice to paradigm, we're now into this new paradigm where we have integrated networks of people, hardware, and software that all function as a uniform conservation tool to provide us the answers to help us manage resources wisely. This network facilitates real-time information sharing, processing, and data delivery while honoring the contributions, mandates, and securities or security issues of all departments. The tool that we built called LC Map has a number of different features, which we'll show you here. Essentially, kind of an overview of it. The main functions are data discovery and acquisition, effective and efficient data storage and data sharing, the ability to access common and analytical and modeling tools, and then to deliver that information that we develop, either output models or value-added data, what have you, to our partners and to the general public. Tim?
Okay. We're going to take a brief detour into some of the technical details that Sean pointed out about what makes up LC Map. And as Sean pointed out, there's a catalog. A catalog is a metadata storage and search tool. Each project, and LC Map was developed, co-developed with the USGS ScienceBase project. So ScienceBase serves a number of different communities. The landscape conservation cooperatives built into ScienceBase a number of capabilities that could be used not just by the LCCs but by these other groups as well. And part of this is the catalog. Each project has a unique context or virtual catalog. So the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative has their own specific area, an area that they control, the data, the content items that they're looking at, that they're using. It's used to discover items not just stored in the LC Map, but also items that may be referenced by LC Map. And we'll get to that in a second. Another component is the repository. And the repository is a data storage and distribution mechanism for native items, items that the conservation cooperatives are building themselves. This interacts with the catalog in that the catalog will capture or store the metadata for every item and then allow people to, from the outside researchers to search and find these data. It also interacts with an enterprise geodatabase, an ArcGIS server instance. And Sean will talk about that in detail when he gets into the real-world application. This ArcGIS share lets the groups do some standard geospatial data manipulation. It works on a subset of the repository data. So if people put data in the repository, they can make it available for sharing and building derivative products within ArcGIS. And it allows people to collaborate on landscape themes. So multi-state projects can build, can work on edge matching, can work on cross-jurisdictional boundary issues, can work on attribute resolution. The way this system is set up to work, and this representation shows a set of boxes. The green boxes, for those of you who are not color impaired, are the core ScienceBase / LC Map components. LC Map and the Landscape Conservation Cooperatives basically built the entire GIS share part as well as a huge part of the repository project. ScienceBase contributed the primary front-end catalog as well as another part of the repository. community, the health conservation GIS specialists, as well as researchers who are using data from them. The purple boxes are groups that don't have anything to do with LCMIP. Those are going to be groups that have their own catalogs, like state agencies. They're going to be they have their own data locally, but they'll provide their metadata for people to search. Model outputs, these are climate, especially climate modelers, will have terabytes and terabytes of data, and they'll provide summaries or ways for people to get to those data without having to transfer those data across the internet. And then other repositories. These other repositories are groups that, like Data Basin, working with the Bureau of Land Management's Rapid Ecological Assessment Group, Data One, these are groups that are somewhat, what we'll call them, that they're working with LCMAP in either through partners or in a collaborative effort. So the way that LCMAP is set up is that primarily a catalog, like a state agency, will expose their metadata. LCMAP will harvest metadata from those state agencies, from the climate modelers, and from the repository. It also allows communities to generate their own GIS data sets. And this would be, and again, these may be some of these same partners that are building very local or statewide data sets that they can contribute to the repository. This allows them to share those data with the rest of the LCMAP, the Great Northern community. LCMAP provides tools to let people develop metadata if they haven't done so already, and that'll be contributed to the catalog so that the data sitting in the repository and the metadata and the catalog are effectively paired. Once that's in place, the LCMAP provides ways for people to move their data from the repository into a GIS share, share their data with ArcGIS users. These GIS users can also use LCMAP to find climate summaries or model outputs that they can bring in, as well as grab data from other repositories to build a derivative data set in this GIS share and contribute back to the repository. Once that's done, of course, there's metadata construction tools that help the users describe the data they've just built, which then becomes part of the catalog. And then users from the outside, researchers, managers, can do searches against the catalog, against the metadata, to basically get that data onto their local systems to look at the data, to view the data, and interact with the data as they need it to see fit. Now, LCMAP is a web application primarily. It has some components that work with your client, ArcGIS, but there's a whole tier out there that's not exposed, that users generally don't see, and that has to do with the web services. These web services and application programming interface allow other applications to take advantage of LCMAP. And just a brief summary, basically web services and application programming interfaces, that's how different applications can interact with the data in any other server set. The web services, that's basically just getting data that your machine can read and translate for you. And we're talking about GIS data. That can be a REST service, a web mapping service, web feature service, web cover service. There's a variety of different protocols that you can work with. When you're working with querying and editing data, there's another set of protocols. So LCMAP supports all of these different types of web services, as well as working with some custom services that were for individual partners that we're dealing with. The application's programming interface is a way that your developers, if you have web developers, can add, edit, delete data and references in LCMAP without ever really touching any of the web parts of LCMAP. So other portals can basically just use LCMAP as a data repository if they'd like it. They can grab those data and references and put it in their own applications. They can actually build an interface that you can contribute data from your own portal back to LCMAP. That allows your group to share data constructively with the landscape conservation cooperatives while still maintaining control of how your users see those data, how they interact with those data. So LCMAP, and again, this is going to be very brief. We're going to give it back to Sean, who's actually going to talk about real-world applications. If anybody's interested, this is built as a Java-based application with Java charting and Java content repositories. It works against some open source tools, some open source databases. It takes advantage of some open source projects. DSRI recently released their GeoPortal project as an open source project, which we borrowed liberally from. It has some open source metadata collection and edit tools. And since it is built on open source products, it is in fact open source itself. It can be downloaded and reviewed by another developer if they want to take the source code and customize it. They can do that as well, and it's available via an open source project. It has some proprietary additions, and that would be essentially the ArcGIS component. LCMap understands what to do when you upload a shapefile or upload a geotiff or upload an Esri map package. If there is a proprietary format, then it's going to take advantage of the, it takes advantage of the proprietary tools. These tools aren't available from us if you need to download it, but the configuration files or how the system interacts with it are. You can get a hold of the actual component configuration files that we use. But the user who would download it would be responsible for setting up their own ArcGIS instances. Working with ArcGIS and GIS in general is somewhat of a challenge, and that's been a very big... Sean pointed out there's a lot of security behind this. We make sure that users who upload data or contribute data have control of who can see those data, that community managers can control what parts of their community can see what data at what stage in its lifetime. The ArcGIS part has its own special considerations. Everything here is available over the Internet. That means when you're on your ArcGIS client, and Sean will demonstrate this, you're connecting over a secure Internet connection. To make sure that works without running afoul of any security measures, that means that the user has a little bit of insulation between, there's a bit of insulation between the user and the data. There's a web proxy that prevents basically denial of service attacks, intrusion detection system to make sure that nobody, nefarious actions aren't going on to your data. The web server, of course, has its own tier of security you can put in place. There's a proxy server as well. We make sure we hide the servers behind any of the front-end entry points so that somebody, even if they had a chance to get into the system, could never find the actual servers where the data resides. Application servers distribute the request to a number of different containers so that we can have a lot of simultaneous multiple usage. Of course, ArcGIS has its own service manager as well as its own service containers, and we connect to an Arc SDE connector to the database before you get to the data. So the entire tier is somewhat, there's a lot of insulation between the user and the data. So with that, I'm going to turn this back over to Sean, who's going to talk about real-world applications of LCMap.
Thanks, Tim. That was great. And if I could just embellish on one of the things that Tim brought up, and that is the fact that we use ArcGIS, the Esri product, the proprietary product, as our GIS application. We went around a lot about that one because there are obviously open source opportunities to do GIS. But we ended up deciding on Arc, even though it can be an expensive package and it's proprietary. And so therefore, anybody who's using LCMap effectively, at least from a geospatial analysis standpoint, will have to have an ArcGIS license. We felt that the support that you get from DSRI in terms of users' manuals and discussion forums and tips and tricks and things like that was so valuable, and if we were going to go with an open source ArcGIS solution, we would have to do a lot of that sort of user support and technical guide stuff ourselves. And so the trade-off was, do we want to spend lots and lots of money and time to try and build something from the ground up, or do we want to use something that is proven effective and can integrate very well with the rest of LCMap, even though some of our partners might not have licensees? And, you know, I'm really kind of looking at maybe smaller NGOs here or private enterprises that are partnering with GNLCC or partners in an LCMap project. And we felt like GNLCC had the capacity to help those partners get an ARC license in some form or another, and therefore participate in large landscape conservation would be an easier route. And so if you're in that situation where you're interested in this product, but you don't have an ArcGIS license, well, please contact me or one of our partners, and we'll work towards helping you get that. So thanks again, Tim. That was great discussion of the architecture. A lot of that stuff is highly technical, and I hope that there are folks on the call right now that can follow up with some questions to clarify any of those things if they're not important. But we're going to move into a sort of a demonstration phase here, where I'm going to show a demonstration of some of the features that you can get out of the catalog, then the repository, and then the ArcGIS share. So I show this first screen here to show you that all of this information, to actually get the information or to manipulate it or to download it, you need to have authentication. And in this particular case, this is the screen you're going to see if you are trying to get into the data catalog and steal some of our data. We're not going to let you. The way that you do that is by requesting a user account, and we provide you with a user ID and a password, and that's how you access the features that are associated with LCMAP. So the catalog here should look a lot like just any kind of file manager that you're familiar with, except it has that geospatial component here. And I'm going to flip through a couple of screenshots of the data catalog, and there's a lot of stuff here to cover. So kind of keep your eyes open, because I'm probably not going to mention it every time I switch screens here. But if you look over on the right-hand side of your map, you'll see that there's a map of the United States, and you can manipulate by zooming in, zooming out, panning around, and stuff like that. But the actual base map that you look at, there's a couple of different things. You can look at, for example, a digital line graph here, like you're looking at, or there's also some imagery in the background, and you can see those tabs that you can click on. When I go from one screen to the next, the view of that map is going to change a little bit. That's just to show you that there's lots of different possibilities for you to sort of look at the background information while you're looking at the geospatial data. Essentially, the catalog is a search tool. That's the search tool, at least for the data that's held within the catalog, or the metadata that's held within the catalog, is managed through a series of communities. We mentioned communities before. In this particular case, you can see the highlight of the GNLCC community. The way that these communities are structured, they're essentially folders, and access to the folders is identified through your username and account. So not only do these folders sort of represent the hierarchical structure of the way that the data and the metadata are stored, but it also represents the way that that communities and sub-communities are defined, and the access to data is available. So here, in this particular case, I clicked on the search feature up towards the top there, and it's the view switches to a number of large-scale themes or item types source material here. And so in this particular case, I clicked on a tab that says Data Owner, and it basically identifies in a summary format all of the data that's available through the data catalog right now. And again, the catalog sort of stretches out and reaches out and searches for data in a much broader community than just LCMAP or just the LCCs. You can see here there's data in this particular case showing you from the Texas Bureau of Economic Geology. So if that's something that interests you, there are actually 282,000 items that are generated through the Texas Bureau of Economic Geology, and so there's a tremendous amount of information that's available through the catalog. One of our challenges is to help the user sort through that information pretty quickly and effectively to find what they're looking for, and I think there's over 1.5 million items that are available through the catalog at this point. Not all of them are geospatial data, but there's a lot of geospatial data on there, and perhaps you're looking for things like documents or websites or other types of non-spatial data. That stuff is available and searchable through the data catalog as well. Here I just showed you an example of some of the types of data. As I mentioned, Some of the data is offline data. There are maps, publications, projects, websites, et cetera, et cetera. You can see that there's a number of other tools up by the top there. In this particular case, I wanted to show how I might go about adding a new item or actually uploading files here. Again, I would only be able to do this if I had permission to do so. The drop-down in kind of the upper center part of the screen. Also, on the right-hand side of the screen near the top, I show you that there are a number of different search functions here. You could just kind of do a general broad search for those 1.5 million items, or you could specify your search a little bit more, for example, in an advanced search feature. And I guess I didn't show that the interface for that advanced search feature. But here in this particular case, I was looking for data. I used the search function just to find data that are associated with the word deer, right? So you might expect that those were information about distributions of deer or locations of observations or what have you, but they could also be things like this second item you see right down here, migration corridors or routes to white-tailed deer. So that might be the output of the model based on some user observations, right? And what you see over here is that, first of all, there are eight records that fit deer. That's displaying results 1 and 8. And each one of them are geo-referenced on the map. You can see that. This question mark here indicates that there's more than one of the return items basically has the same spatial footprint. And so by zooming into that particular question mark, you would be able to find out more information. Here's another example where I broadened out my search to wildlife. I wanted to see what I could find out about wildlife in the western U.S. And you can see that just the term wildlife returned 7,800 records here. And again, they're geospatially referenced. If the particular data set does have a geospatial footprint, in other words, it's spatial data, we indicate whereabouts you can find that data in the western U.S. You'll notice that there are a number of links here that get you more information about the data and eventually information about how you access that data, either through some form of web service or perhaps if it's only available by download, that might be your route to grab it. But here's a quick example where I clicked on one of those circles that said that there was more information about the data, and in this particular case, I'm looking at letter B there, the greater sage-grouse historic distribution during the early 1800s, et cetera, et cetera. There is more info, and there's kind of a brief, kind of abstract-level piece of information there where you can get, for example, the title and the data owner, how the data is served or delivered, whether it's online data or downloadable data. You also get a brief abstract. This is drawn directly from the metadata record. Usually that would be the FGDC metadata format, but the catalog is able to read a number of metadata formats and deliver that information to you. And you might also notice, well, there's a show footprint link here, which will show you an actual footprint on the landscape about where that data is. I'm not going to show you that, but I will here click on the more info, and that brings us to a more elaborate group of the metadata where you can get a lot more information about that particular metadata and then the links to the web services that actually allow you to grab that data and use it on your desktop. The repository's primary function is to serve as a location where particular groups or communities can store their data. Again, it's hierarchically structured, and those hierarchies are very implicit in the way that the securities and the access to this data are delivered. So you cannot access data on the repository or upload data or download it without a username and password. And the way that we handle that right now is you just send an email to myself or someone else associated with LCMAP, and we will assign you a username and password after a brief vetting process to make sure you know you're who you are and we like you and those kinds of things. again, it's very secure. So if you're concerned about where this data might end up or whose hands it might end up in, it just can't get outside of the system without proper credentials. And here's an example from the repository here. Again, it's very much folder-based, and the data resides in folders, and permissions to individuals are identified based on those folders here. And so, again, you can see that there's a GNLCC folder here, and we have subfolders in there that give us information or allow access to various subsets of the data that's in the GNLCC repository. You might also notice that the Great Plains LCC has a folder as well as a number of other of these large regional landscape groups. So we're not thinking of these things sort of in isolation, but we also have a shared vision across the United States and with all of our partners nationally and internationally. So you can see here what I did was I simply clicked on that GNLCC folder and we looked down into a series of subfolders here. Again, there's all kinds of hierarchical arrangements that we can manage here and with permissions associated on those arrangements. In this particular place, you can see that we only have folders for things like drafts, presentation materials, provisional, published, and working folders. Now, depending on the access route you are provided, and that's determined by your particular community manager, it determines what individuals can do in each one of these folders. So, for example, your author, which is a relatively low-level permission, they can get in there and they can upload data and they can do some metadata editing, but they can't move those folders around. In other words, people who are just authors can only put data into the draft folder, but they can't actually move it to the published folder. The community manager would be the one that goes through that process, and that's essentially integrated into the kind of QA/QC process where everyone on the team agrees through the auspices of the project manager or the community manager that the data is ready for larger distribution, and the community manager moves it from one folder to another. It's kind of simple and elegant, and an easy way for people to always know what the status of a particular data set is without having to delve too deeply into the metadata or associated information with a particular data set. Also in the repository are a whole series of tools that allow you to view the data, download and upload data sets into the repository. You could create new folders, particularly those of project managers or higher level permission folks that can do that, and also a series of other actions here. So here in this particular case, I just clicked on one of the data layers that was in the draft folder here, and the screen changes to show you some information about that particular data set. Again, you'll notice we're looking at mule deer range data. It's in the state of Wyoming. You can tell that by the map interface here. there's also some basic information that's generated from the metadata, that tells you what you're looking at, including the projection, the spatial data type, the author, etc. And you can see that in this particular case, if it's in the draft folder, it is metadata, and here you can see that GDC metadata and all the information that you need to understand what this data is stored in this metadata record. And when I show you that we'll have the possibility of editing various kinds of data in the GIS share, which is our next demonstration here,
those edits are automatically generated and uploaded back into this metadata record to kind of keep a real-time record of how the data is changed through time. When a data set is changed, and I'll show you this in ArcGIS Share, it is given a new version number so that the old data set is saved and the new data set is also available. And you can work sort of in a collaborative sense across large landscapes from multiple agencies or organizations, on various jurisdictions, and work collaboratively sort of across the web. It's GIS in the cloud, if you will. So when I give you a demonstration of the GIS share here, I'm going to kind of give you a little story here. It's ginned up, so don't think there's anything particularly sensitive about this information. But it's based on some real data. And so let's say particularly we have this challenge where we have this multi-agency, multi-entity team, and we want to evaluate sage grouse lek attendance in response to natural gas development in Wyoming. So our fictitious team here consists of a BLS field office manager, someone from the state of Wyoming, Game and Fish Department, let's say a graduate student who's actually out there doing some of the field work as part of their graduate work for the University of Wyoming, and then myself, because I need to be involved in everything. And here's our little team here, and our goal here is to understand how sage grouse might respond to natural gas development. Now, you might recognize that if you're in that part of the world, that development and changes to the landscape due to oil and gas development can happen pretty quickly. So what we want to do here for this particular exercise is we want to map road and rail construction shortly after it occurs on the landscape, and then prioritize some leks for surveys. The BLM field office manager needs to know which leks might be affected by development, and they need to communicate to that graduate student to go out and survey those particular leks. So that's our problem statement here. So here I am sitting in my office in Boise or Fort Collins or Rapid City, South Dakota. It doesn't matter, right? This is all happening through the internet, but I'm using ArcGIS on my desktop as my tool to do the work that I need to do. In this particular case, if you're familiar with ArcGIS, I'm just looking at a project I just opened up. I put on a coverage or a layer of the states in the United States as my kind of reference data. But what I want to do, because I want to look at this development as it's occurring, I need to pull up some imagery. So should I have some imagery that's sitting on my desktop that my partner in Laramie or Cheyenne or Pinedale would have difficulty accessing? No, it would be much better if that data was in some centralized location. And using the catalog, I was able to discover that there's an aerial photo field office in Salt Lake City that's managed by the U.S. Department of Agriculture. And they serve eight data through web services. So here, when I go to add data, and if you're familiar with GIS, you know that's a common practice. You add data, but instead of pulling something from my C drive here, I'm pulling some information from a GIS server. And so I click on that, and I have the URL, and I found that URL by my search through the catalog, and I found the aerial photo field office web services right here. I type that URL into my add data function here, and you might notice that down below here there's an option to put in authentication, but I don't need to because the aerial photo field office is serving this data without any securities involved in it. And I'll show you later on how the security features come into play here, but when I click finish, essentially in my add data dialog box, you can see that the aerial photo field office service is available to me. Now, I just basically search through their file structure looking for the data that I want, very similar to looking to your hard drive or some network that your agency manages. And when I find the data that I'm looking for, Wyoming NAEP data, I say add data, right? I'm not downloading this NAEP data to my hard drive, so I'm not filling up my hard drive, and I'm not putting some version or lineage of this data that then sort of sits on my hard drive and becomes inaccessible to other people. Just calling the data through the web and incorporating into my ArcGIS project here. And so I think everyone agrees that aerial photo imagery from the state of Wyoming. I zoomed in a little bit, and so now I can begin to start thinking about some of my processes here. And the process here, I asked the GIS specialist for Wyoming Fish and Game to do some digitization on quickly developing changes to the landscape. So they need to figure out where our project is. And in this particular case, they go back to an ArcGIS service. They add the URL for our repository where we're storing some of this data. Again, you can see the S there, right, and the HTTPS. It indicates a secure location. The URL is just your standard URL. But if I would have hit finish here without putting in my authentication, I wouldn't be allowed to access this data. If I have a username and a password, I'm able to access this data on the repository. When I hit finish here, again, I'm looking in a file structure that is associated with the Great Northern LCC. I chose a set of data called sample data, well pads, and I added that to my project here. Now, it has a much smaller footprint than, for example, the state of Wyoming here. They're looking at a very specific area within the Pinedale field office in the state of Wyoming. And so let's zoom into that area here, and you can see not only do we have that named imagery in the background that's being called from one server, but we also have this oil and gas development data that's being called from another server, which is the repository for the LC map. Okay, I want to work in the southeast corner of this particular data layer here. You can see there's some development that we don't have digitized here, and my job in this particular example is to digitize some additional information here so we can find out what's going on with LECT in this part of the world. So I zoom in here, and I want to start editing this data. Remember, data that's showing the oil and gas development is sitting on a server here, and I don't actually do the editing right to the server. Instead, what I do is when I'm ready to edit this particular data set, I right-click on the data set, and hopefully you can all see this on your screen. I right-click and I select Edit Features, and then I copy, create a local copy for editing. What that does is it replicates temporarily that spatial data on my desktop so that I can begin to do the editing. There are a number of reasons why we replicate it this way. First of all, it maintains integrity for the data that's sitting on the server, so people like me who tend to screw things up a lot won't screw up the source data, and also the actual editing process occurs much more efficiently when you're just working on your desktop. So in this particular case, I need to digitize a little bit more information about oil and gas development here. You might also notice here that when I was fooling around with this and creating this demonstration, I added information from another web service, and that's just the National Hydrography data set. So we see some hydrography data in there as well. You can see it's very flexible. Provided the data is being delivered through web services from somewhere, you can access it and use it either as a reference point or actually replicate it and begin to edit it on your local machine. And that's what I did here. So here's the data that's sitting on the server, and there's also a copy, an exact copy of the oil and gas data that's now replicated on my desktop. I go to the editor feature that you can see in the upper left part of your screen, and I say start editing, and the enhanced editing function in ArcGIS becomes available to me. If you haven't used ArcGIS 10, by the way, you know, a lot of these things are a lot more easily accessible and understandable, and so if you haven't used it yet, you're going to like it, I think. But in this particular case, I wanted to start editing some features. So you can see I added a well pad here, and I added some pipelines. I think those pipelines or roads, I should say, that go to this well pad. I also edited in some pipelines here, so now I have a little bit more information about the development that's occurring in this particular area. This is where the graduate student works. What we want to know is what's going on with Sagecraft Next in that particular area here. So when I'm done with my editing, I go back to the editor feature over here on the left side, and I say Save Edit. That saves the edits to my machine, and then I go and go back to the data layer, and when I say Edit Features, I say synchronize local edits to the server, and what that does is it takes the edits that I just created and it places them back on the repository. Now, it doesn't, as I said, it doesn't replace the data that's already on the repository. What it does is assign a new version number and a new spatial data layer and automatically updates the metadata so that it records the IP address and the time when the edits occur. So you need to go in and actually obviously augment some of that metadata so that you can explain exactly what you did to change the data. But it basically maintains the original copy so that if something tragic happened, it was always available for you. But it also gives you the newer version, but in this case, the updated digitized. gas development. You see those stage graph flecks are demonstrated by the yellow triangles. Essentially, this data is also on the server. I did the same thing. I called up the GIS service, and I asked for the data, and it delivers the data to my desktop. I want to do some analyses on it. I can replicate it to my desktop, but in this particular case, I just want to show you something simple here. I wanted to find out, so I can tell this graduate student where they should be going on a particular day to do their surveys, which one of these lecks are within 150 meters of any of this development. So it's a very simple GIS function. GIS people are very familiar with this simple function. I just say, in this particular case, I want to do a selection. I select by location. It gives me a pop-up box where I define this selection process. I want to select features from the stage graph, the Pinedale lex here. I want to find out which of these lex are within 150 meters of that oil and gas data here, which is called test editing data. So then I click OK here. You can see those lex that met that search criteria, that selection criteria, highlighted here. Now, as the BLM manager, I can call up the graduate student or send them an email or send this map out, or graduate student can actually, you know, go on and take a look at this data themselves, go on LC map, and they'll know which data to go out and to survey. So that's kind of a basic demonstration of ArcGIS, the ArcGIS server portion or the ArcGIS share portion of LC map. So in summary, I'd just like to say that LC map provides this virtual collaboration, this data discovery, management, and analysis tool. It kind of addresses all those things we talked about at the beginning of the talk here. It provides integration for users, software, and hardware, which are all facilitated by a suite of web service protocols. Project-specific data access is finally customizable and it's always secure. In other words, the project manager has final say over who accesses the data and how it's delivered to various audiences, be it projects, larger groups of projects, or the general public. Project managers have full control. The data remains fully editable and retrievable in real time, and the metadata is automatically updated. And I think basically we have one more slide here, which iterates some of the things that we've already talked about here. So with that, I'd like to finish up and open up the discussion for any questions. Again, just to remind you, the format for asking questions is by typing them into the chat feature, and Leslie, who is in Bozeman, will read those questions in order to us. Tim and I, and Leanne, and Don Brown, who's also here, will do our best to answer these questions. Thanks very much for joining.
Great. Thank you, guys. And we do have some questions for you. The first one is from Jim Lindstrom. And he asks, and you've likely covered this already, who is the target audience or user group for the LC map?
I'd say that there's multiple target audiences for LC map. We know that the GIS share, the target audience for the GIS share is going to be GIS professionals, GIS analysts, modelers, people working within the ArcGIS or GIS environment. The repository tool and the core catalog and repository tool has two different audiences. Number one is the researcher who needs to share their data, needs to get their data into a shareable location, as well as the researchers who want to use those data. So it's sort of a general research audience. Managers, there's a suite of tools to allow managers to see the state of, when I say managers, that's project managers, to see the state of where project data and deliverables are and how and where the metadata, state of the metadata for them. There's a last audience, which is the public. For those items that have, and by the public I mean people who aren't necessarily LC map authorized users, but they want to find data. That group can use the catalog search to find and access any of the items that have been declared public. If a community manager or project manager
as a deliverable. The publication is out. It's already going through the review process. If they feel comfortable with it, it is considered good to go. Then those data would be declared public and accessible to non-LC map authorized users.
This is Sean. If I could just add in, really the target audience is anybody who's working on large landscape collaboration. So I'm hoping and expecting that's just about all of us that work in natural resource management and science these days.
Great. Thank you. Our next question is from Mike Frame. He actually has two questions. First, very impressive activity tools, and it sounds like you guys are truly leading data management within the LCC network. My question is, I didn't hear much attention or much mention of data and metadata standards being supported. Could you please touch on your approach and use of standards? Thanks.
And to address Mike's question, very good question, Mike. Mike is involved in the Data One project. We've been working with Data One on some of these questions. The LC map and ScienceBase tools do not, they're metadata standard agnostic. They basically see metadata as an import format and an export format. So FGDC metadata, which is right now the primary metadata format that is being worked with inside of LC map, it would be ingested, would be imported into the data structure, and then exported as the format that somebody would need. Now, there's a number of tools that we have not built yet, and that is the mapping between FGDC and some of the ISO standards. Those are currently under construction. But the idea would be that, again, using some of the tools that, in fact, Mike has worked on over the last few years, people would be able to have their metadata imported and then exported in a number of different formats depending on what they needed for later use.
From the user's end, the catalog harvests the elements that make up the metadata and interprets them or translates or delivers them in a little bit more plain language. And it's very flexible in the sense that, of course, various kinds of metadata standards are readable by LC map and returned to the user.
Great. And Mike's follow-up question is, have you guys considered using DOIs as a unique identifier for your metadata and data sets? This would allow for linkages to publications, easily sharing metadata to other clearinghouses, maintaining versions of metadata and data, et cetera.
Yeah, the DOIs, basically those identifiers. Yes, we've considered it. We have an identifier built into all of the items in the catalog or repository. As far as the integration with library items that has not been done yet, yes, we are considering it. We definitely have it on our map. It's a matter of getting some of the new ones figured out and getting it prioritized. But that definitely has to, we think that has to happen.
Great. And it looks like our final question of the hour is from Megan Burns. Great presentation. In regards to the science support viewer, can ArcGIS Explorer be interchanged with ArcGIS to meet the needs of users that want to view and present the data versus edit the data? Thanks.
Yes, and as far as ArcGIS Explorer, again, the science viewer, we're trying to make sure we have more integration points with. Users who are working with ArcGIS Explorer can access all of these services, all of the output services, the same way you would within ArcGIS. The question comes as to whether or not you can securely edit things. And ArcGIS Explorer isn't really meant as an editor tool. But as far as a visualization and a consumer of all these things, absolutely. Now, one of the things that we've learned recently is that we have to get a variety, and not just for ArcExplorer, but we have to make sure that more of our services are, we have to get a broader range of services exposed for some of these viewers. So we're starting with ArcExplorer and making sure that we can get these, again, the data out in all of the different ways that make sense. And then we're going to work through the other formats as by request from the community. But the same type of thing, if you're on a desktop, if you're in the Science Viewer, if you're in any of ArcGIS Explorer tools, you can get data the exact same way. You would connect to the server. You would have, there'd be some data that was publicly accessible, some data that was repository items that were not restricted would be publicly accessible. Other ones would be accessible just via an access restriction.
Great. Thanks for that. And that's all the questions we have, unless we have a last-minute one, and it doesn't appear that we do. So thank you, everyone, for joining us. Thank you, Sean, Tim, and Leanne, for the excellent seminar. And we'll see you or listen to you, or we will all come together at the next one. Thank you. Have a wonderful day.
Thanks very much, Leslie. I appreciate your help in getting this information out. And I should add to any of our listeners, please visit the GNLCC website, and there you can find contact information for me. If you have any other follow-up questions, please ask them via email. Also, this, like all of the webinars that GNLCC puts on, are live streamed, and you are able to get that by going to the webinar page on the GNLCC website and viewing it at your leisure.